The title of the third of our lectures is The Forms of Old Testament Prophecy. The Old Testament prophets were not only poets, they were performers. Indeed, as poets, they had to be performers, for only by being performers could they convey their poetry to the people they needed to reach. In ancient Israel and Judah, the skills of reading and writing were mostly the preserve of the scribes, who were employed in the royal court and the temple, and who had been trained at a tribal school. Furthermore, the lack of any kind of writing materials for general use meant that most ordinary people had no occasion or need to read and write. If it was necessary to have a legal document drawn up, for example, to prove ownership of land, this was done by a scribe, just as today we would use a solicitor to produce a similar legal document. When the prophets delivered their messages to ordinary people, they did this orally, and in order to gain attention and an audience, they used various devices to draw attention to themselves. In Jeremiah chapter 27, the prophet is commanded to take thongs and yoke bars and to wear them on his neck. This clearly would draw attention to him. He is to do this as a sign to the envoys of various local small nations who've come to Jerusalem to consult with King Zedekiah. They are the envoys of the kings of Edom, Moab, Ammon, Tyre, and Sidon. The message that Jeremiah is to convey is that all these nations will become subject to Nebuchadnezzar, the king of Babylon. In order to avoid disaster, these nations will need to put their necks under the yoke of the king of Babylon, otherwise disaster will come upon them. In Jeremiah chapter 19, the prophet is told to go and buy an earthen flask, and to go with it and some of the elders and senior priests to the valley of the son of Hinnom. This is the place where the rubbish was burned in ancient Jerusalem. When the prophet has delivered his message, he is to break the flask in the sight of his listeners and to say that the city and its inhabitants and its houses will be broken in the way that the flask has been broken because of the disobedience of the people of Judah and Jerusalem and their refusal to hear God's words through the prophets. In the first book of Kings, chapter 11, the prophet Ahijah takes a new garment which he is wearing and tears it into 12 pieces. He gives 10 pieces to Jeroboam, who will later lead a revolt of the northern tribes against the son of Solomon, Rehoboam. This symbolizes the fact that the united kingdom of David and Solomon will be divided, that Jeroboam will have 10 of the 12 tribes, and that only 2 will be left to the house of David. An older generation of Old Testament scholarship that did not understand the nature of symbolic actions tended to describe incidents such as these as instances of magic or magical beliefs, with the physical action being believed to put into effect the words that were being spoken. We now know much more about symbolic actions, and we're on safer ground if we assume that the symbolic actions had the main purpose of attracting an audience to hear the prophet's words. Now, the incidents that I've described are relatively straightforward, but there are some complicated ones that call for further explanation. Before I consider them, however, I want to refer to another incident in the book of Jeremiah, which indicates the oral nature of the messages of the prophets, how they reached an audience, and how they came to be written down. In the year 605 BC, the prophet Jeremiah was instructed by God to dictate to his secretary, Baruch, the words of prophecy which Jeremiah had spoken up to that point. Because Jeremiah was debarred from going to the temple, we don't know exactly why, Jeremiah instructed Baruch to go to the temple on a fast day when many people would be coming to the temple in connection with the fast. Baruch was to read out to all the people who were there the words that Jeremiah had dictated. This Baruch did in the following year, 604 BC. Baruch read Jeremiah's words aloud in the temple, in the chamber of Gemariah, the son of Shaphan, the secretary, in the upper court at the entry of the new gate of the Lord's house. One of the sons of Gemariah went to the royal palace and informed the nobles who were there of what was going on. The nobles sent word that Baruch and the scroll should be brought to them. Baruch came and read it to them, whereupon they decided that it was necessary for the king, Jehoiakim, to know what had happened. They also wanted to know from where Baruch had got the scroll, to which he replied that Jeremiah had dictated it. The nobles told Baruch and Jeremiah to go into hiding. The group now proceeded to the king's court, where they reported to the king what had gone on. The king ordered that the scroll should be read in his presence. We are told that it was the ninth month, which probably means that it was autumn, and that the king was sitting in his winter house in front of a fire burning in a brazier. As the scroll was read to him, the king took a penknife and cut off each portion of the scroll after it had been read and threw it into the brazier until the entire scroll had been consumed by the fire. We are told that none of those who heard what was in the scroll showed any kind of remorse or emotion. The king ordered that Jeremiah and Baruch should be brought to him, but they could not be found. So far, I have mentioned cases of performance that can easily be understood. I now turn to ones that, on the face of it, are puzzling. In Isaiah chapter 21, verse 2, the prophet is instructed to loose the sackcloth from his loins and to remove his sandals from his feet. It is explained that the prophet had been walking about naked and barefoot for 3 years. Now, the interpretation of this is not easy. Naked clearly does not mean literally without any clothes on. And exactly how the 3 years would be reckoned or counted by those who observed Isaiah's behavior is unclear. However, there is sufficient in the passage to indicate that Isaiah had been dressing in an unusual way that would draw attention to him of the people among whom he lived. We are told that he was to do this as a sign that the king of Assyria would take captive the Egyptians, so that the unusual dress of the prophet would resemble that of Egyptians being marched into exile. Now, whether or not the king of Assyria did in fact defeat Egypt at this time is much discussed in the scholarly literature. For our present purposes, it is sufficient to say that the passage indicates that Isaiah drew attention to himself by means of dressing strangely. In Jeremiah 25, the prophet is told to take from God's hand a cup of the wine of wrath and to cause a number of kings to drink from it. I shall not bother to list all the names of the kings that are mentioned in the text, except to say that last of all, the king of Babylon is to drink. The prophet is to do this as a sign of the judgment of God that is to come upon these nations. The difficulty in the passage is obvious. How is the prophet going to cause the kings of nations from far afield as Egypt, Arabia, Tyre, Sidon, and Babylon to drink from his cup? For the moment, I shall leave the question unanswered and turn to some other problematic examples. In Ezekiel chapter 4, the prophet is told to take a piece of brick and to draw a picture of Jerusalem upon it and to portray siege works and battering rams so that the people who see the brick will see it as a sign that Jerusalem will undergo a siege. Then he is to lie upon his left side for the number of the days of the punishment of Israel, a period of 390 days, symbolizing 390 years. Once he has completed the 390 days, he is to lie on his right side as a sign of the punishment of the house of Judah, in which position he is to lie for 40 days, symbolizing 40 years. Also, he is to wear or to be bound by ropes, which will prevent him from turning from one side to the other until the appointed days have been completed. As in the case of Isaiah going about with unusual clothes for a period of 3 years, we have to ask the question how people would know that 390 days and 40 days had passed. People did not have diaries, and the keeping and recording of dates and time was difficult in the ancient world. And who was to feed Ezekiel while he was lying on his side? How would he discharge his natural functions if he was tied up so that he could not move? We seem to be faced with an impossibility. And yet we must not reach the conclusion that these things did not really happen and that they are simply made up as part of a story. The best solution to these questions was provided some years ago by the German Old Testament scholar Bernhard Lang, although a similar suggestion had been made years earlier by the Israeli scholar Yehezkel Kaufmann. Lang suggested that what we have here are instances of what he called street theatre. The scenes described in Isaiah and Jeremiah and Ezekiel are to be acted out, so that although they are not literally true, they are true in the sense that performances were given that conveyed a message, but which above all set the scene for prophets to deliver their messages to those assembled. Lang defines it as, and I quote, "The performance of street theatre, in which the prophet illustrates his word by game, mime, and props. Isaiah warns of an anti-Assyrian league by appearing in the loincloth of a prisoner of war. Jeremiah buys a big stone jar, smashes it to pieces at Jerusalem's gate of the potsherds, and throws it onto the rubbish dump. Ezekiel acts out the besieging of Jerusalem and enters into a form of hunger strike, eating only bad food in small rations to demonstrate that a shortage of foodstuffs is to be expected. One should not underestimate the provocative effect of such a demonstration in a society which knows of no mass media. The prophets mean to cause a sensation and to challenge a wider public to take a stand. It is the street theatre itself which teaches us to understand the prophets not only as theologians of a meditative bent, but also as showmen, as experts in public agitation and propaganda." I would want to add to this that it was also a way of gathering an audience for the prophets to deliver their message in poetry. Before I leave the subject of street theatre, I want to comment on another passage from a prophetic book and how it may best be understood as a dramatisation. And this brings us back to the Israeli scholar Yehezkel Kaufman and his monumental work in modern Hebrew, The Religion of Israel, Toldot HaEmunah HaYisraelit. The passage is Hosea chapters 1 to 3. The book begins with a passage that has vexed interpreters for centuries. The prophet is instructed to, and I quote, take a wife of harlotry and to have children of harlotry. What does this mean? Some interpreters were troubled by the idea that God could tell the prophet to do something sinful, that is, to marry a prostitute. Another problem is the meaning of the phrase children of harlotry. Even if Hosea's wife had been a prostitute, the children would be legitimately born. So how could they be children of harlotry unless they were to be encouraged by the prophet to engage in the promotion and practice of prostitution, which seems unlikely. There are two sons and a daughter. Something of the difficulty of this passage is seen by the way in which the great Puritan scholar and commentator Matthew Poole handled it. He suggests that if the wife, who is named Gomer, had formerly been a prostitute, she ceased to be so on being married to Hosea, so everything is all right. The phrase children of harlotry may refer to children who had been born to Gomer while she was a prostitute, before her marriage, children who are now accepted into the family by the prophet. Again, all rather nice. Unfortunately, the text rules out such an explanation when it states clearly, she conceived and bore him, that is the prophet, a son. In Hosea chapter 3, the prophet is instructed to, and I quote, love a woman who is beloved of a paramour and is an adulteress. The prophet buys her for 15 shekels of silver and a quantity of barley and says to her, quote, you must dwell as mine for many days. You shall not play the harlot or belong to another man. Poole argues that this woman cannot be the prophet's wife, mentioned in the first chapter, to whom Hosea is still married. This second, previously unmarried woman is to live with him, not to be married with him. In the 19th century, a theory emerged that became widespread in religious education in Britain, certainly after the Second World War. It supposed that taking together chapters 1 to 3 of Hosea were biographical. Hosea had married a woman named Gomer and had had two sons and a daughter. She then left him and became a prostitute. After a period of time, he rediscovered her working as a slave and brought her out of slavery for 15 shekels of silver. Out of this personal tragedy, the prophet came to know something of God's love for a chosen people that had turned away from this love to the carnal delights of the religion of Baal and its sacred prostitution. Although this is a very moving and attractive interpretation, there is nothing in the actual text of Hosea to support it. And it leaves unexplained the perplexing phrases, wife of harlotry and children of harlotry. Further, it doesn't explain another point that I've not yet mentioned, that when the prophet's children are born, he gives them symbolic names. The first son is named Jezreel, as a sign that the house of the Israelite king Jehu will be punished. The daughter is named Not Pitied, Lo Ruchamah, because God will no longer have pity on Israel and Judah. The second son is named Not My People, Lo Ami, as a sign that God is turning his back on his people. These namings are similar to the other symbolic actions that have been mentioned, such as Jeremiah wearing a yoke or smashing the jar. And Kaufman's suggestion that this is all theatrical and dramatic makes sense. The prophet, his wife, and his children act out a drama in which Gomer plays the role of a prostitute, presumably by her dress and gestures. And the children are given the symbolic names that underpin the prophet's message. Kaufman, rightly in my view, sees no connection between chapter 1 and chapter 3 of Hosea. The consideration of street theatre raises an interesting question to which there cannot be a decisive answer, but which is worth raising. I shall shortly show how prophets used forms of speech, such as love songs and funeral dirges, to present their messages. In the passages that I shall cite, there is no mention of the prophets wearing any special clothing. But one wonders if the funeral dirge was delivered while the prophet was wearing sackcloth and ashes, or the love song was delivered in dress appropriate to a wooing or a wedding. The love song that I want to discuss comes in Isaiah chapter 5, and you have it in your handout. And this is in the translation of Robert Lowth, about whom we heard a lot in the first lecture. Let me sing now a song to my beloved, a song of loves concerning his vineyard. My beloved had a vineyard on a high and fruitful hill, and he fenced it round, and he cleaned it from stones, and he planted it with the vine of Sorek, and he built a tower in the midst of it, and he hewed out also a lake therein, and he expected that it should bring forth grapes, but it brought forth poisonous berries. And now, O inhabitants of Jerusalem and ye men of Judah, judge, I pray you, between me and my vineyard. What could have been done more to my vineyard than I have done to it? Why, when I expected that it should bring forth grapes, brought it forth poisonous berries? But come now, and I will make known unto you what I propose to do to my vineyard. To remove its hedge, and it shall be devoured. To destroy its fence, and it shall be trodden down. And I will make it a desolation. It shall not be pruned, neither shall it be digged. But the briar and the thorn shall spring up in it, and I will command the clouds that they shed no rain upon it. Verily, the vineyard of Jehovah, God of hosts, is the house of Israel, and the men of Judah the plant of his delight. And he looked for judgment, but behold, tyranny, and for righteousness, but behold, the cry of the oppressed. In view of what I said earlier about the possibility of the prophet wearing appropriate clothing when delivering this message, it is noteworthy that Bernhard Doom suggests that the prophet is wearing the mask of a folk singer, which he removes when he gets to the point of challenging his hearers to come to a decision. A generally held view connects the passage with the kind of speech that the friend of a bridegroom might make at a wedding. We can think in our own culture of the best man at a wedding, telling the assembled guests about the achievements of the bridegroom. The speaker describes how the friend chose an excellent location for his vineyard, made the very best preparation for its soil and protection from wild animals and thieves, and planted the best variety of grapes possible. The meaning of the words rendered by Louth as vine of Sorek assumes that the plants came from the valley of Sorek, south of Jerusalem, which was renowned for the quality of its grapes. Today's scholarship connects the name with words in the Semitic languages for redness and suggests that a variety of red grape is indicated. The Hebrew word translated by Louth as poisonous berries may be connected with a Hebrew verb that means to smell or to stink, or it may be a weed that resembles a vine. At this point, the speaker changes from the friend of the owner of the vineyard and asks the listeners to make a judgment. The procedure is similar to what happens with some of the parables, for example, the Good Samaritan, when Jesus says, you know, which of you, which man of these do you think was the neighbor? What would they, the listeners, do, given that the hopes of the husbandman had been so cruelly disappointed? At this stage, we must remember that we are dealing with prophetic poetry and not viticulture. There could be several ways of dealing with the problem that the best grapes had produced something worthless. For example, one could try planting a different variety of grapes. To demolish the whole vineyard, to let it be trampled by wild beasts, to make it suffer drought and produce thorns and briars seems to be far too drastic. And perhaps the listeners were expected to feel like that. What began as a song praising a friend had turned into something very provocative. The climax arrives as the prophet applies the song to his listeners. Whatever they may have thought of the drastic action of the husbandman, God, by implication, is determined to make a desolation of his people that they may well think is completely uncalled for. The grapes and the poisonous berries are now given a meaning, and in doing this, the prophet uses wordplay, which is apparent even given our scanty knowledge of how Hebrew was pronounced. God looked for judgment, mishpat, and what resulted was tyranny, mispach. He looked for righteousness, tzedakah, but what came was oppression, tzedakah. At this point, it may be well to recall the quotation I used last week from Friedrich Gundolf's book on Stefan George, to the effect that George was not simply a man disillusioned with his world. His no came from a mighty yes as he saw a vision of hope. The same is true here. The part of the poem that speaks of the careful preparation of the vineyard points to God's work in bringing the Israelites from slavery and planting them in a land flowing with milk and honey. The purpose of this was not to provide a dwelling place where the Israelites could enjoy a comfortable life. The aim was to create a people that enabled in its social interactions the graciousness that God had shown in redeeming and establishing the people. God looked for judgment and justice, but did not find them. Isaiah is not a secular liberal humanist who opposes inequality and exploitation. He is a prophet of the kingdom of justice and righteousness that God, the creator of the universe, has established. He is the herald of a hope that in obedience to God, an ideal society can be created. The behavior of the people is not an offense against human decency. It is an offense against God, who has established the vineyard. The yes that God has spoken to his people in establishing them created the no, which was the people's answer to him and to each other. The passage was originally heard by an audience that was at first intrigued and then provoked by it. As it has come down to us, it can be read at a much deeper level than was possible for those who first heard it. I turn from a love song to a funeral dirge found at the beginning of Amos 5, and you have that on your handout, and here it is in my translation. Hear this word which I lift up against you as a lamentation, O house of Israel. Fallen no more to rise up is virgin Israel. She lies prostrate on her land, no one helps her up. For thus says the Lord God, the city from which 1,000 went will retain only 100. And from the one from which 100 went will only 10 remain. For thus says the Lord to the house of Israel, seek me, then you shall live. Do not seek Bethel. Do not go to Gilgal. Gilgal will surely be taken captive, and Bethel will become Aven. Now, we have seen in these lectures that there is disagreement among scholars as to whether we can recover Hebrew metre. But according to many commentators, Amos chapter 5, verses 2 to 3, as an example of kina or lament rhythm, in which a line of five stresses is divided into a three, followed by a two. In my translation, I've tried to indicate this. Fallen no more to rise up represents three stresses, and is virgin Israel represents two. It has been further suggested that this 3-2 pattern imitated a limping dance that was performed at funerals. It is possible then that the prophet was wearing dress suitable for mourning, and that he delivered his message singing a funeral dirge and performing a limping dance. The Hebrew verbs at the beginning of the first and second lines of the lamentation, translated as fallen and prostrate, are in what we call the completed aspect. That is, they describe the things as completed, whether or not they have yet happened or are likely to happen. Completed and pending aspects are features of modern Slavonic languages, such as Russian and Polish, as well as some forms of modern Arabic. The prophet is not describing a past event, nor is he predicting a coming one. He is seeing reality in a special way. The phrase virgin Israel is meant to convey the idea of a young life cut brutally short before it has had the chance to fulfill its potential or to beget offspring. In our gender-conscious age, we might ask why it is virgin Israel and not young man Israel. The answer is that in Hebrew, nations are feminine, and that it would be as odd in Hebrew to speak of young man Israel as it would be in English to speak of mother time or father earth. The young woman's plight is such that even as she lies on her own territory, not foreign land, she has no helper. Such is the fate, or better, the condition of the nation as the prophet sees it. The imagery turns to that of warfare. The term 1,000, 110 refer to military units, not actual numbers of soldiers. But a major disaster is envisaged as a way of describing the state of the people. The prophet does not necessarily have an imminent military campaign in view, but the military language about loss of life is appropriate in a funeral address. There is a ray of hope in this darkness. The prophet speaks in God's name, "Seek me, then you shall live." Life is a gift of God, not merely in a biological sense, but as it embraces social relationships. Beth-El and Gilgal were sanctuaries which Amos's hearers might well visit on pilgrimages. Their drawback for the prophet was that such pilgrimages might give to the people a false sense of security, the feeling that because they had made the pilgrimages, their future prosperity was secured. The prophet makes puns upon the names of the sanctuaries to show that they are human institutions and therefore impermanent. The pun of Gilgal, Ha-Gilgal Galo Yigleh, is striking. The pun on Beth-El depends on the fact that Beth-El means house of God, while Beth-Avin would mean something like house of evil. What in this case does seek me, seek God mean? This is not a plea for the Israelites to go to an alternative sanctuary, such as Jerusalem. It is rather that God's voice can be heard through the prophets. The prophets who speak of God, the Creator and Lord of the universe, and has called Israel into a special relationship with himself in order to be a light to the nations. There is a strong contrast in the funeral address between life and death. Life comes from hearing and obeying God's word through the prophets. Death comes from ignoring their voice and from believing that outward religious observances, such as pilgrimages, can take the place of reliance upon God's living word and obedience to it. Like the love song in Isaiah 5, the funeral dirge in Amos 5 reveals depths of significance to those of us who can read and study them today. I want to conclude by referring briefly to the so-called messenger formula. This was a convention which kings used in the ancient world to convey messages to each other. Klaus Westermann has traced it as far back as the 3rd millennium BC city of Mari on the Euphrates River in the northeast of Syria, close to the border with Iraq. I was lucky to be there 20 years ago and shudder to think what it's like there today. What I shall say this evening is an oversimplification of Westermann's extensive discussion, but will indicate the main points as they affect this lecture on the Old Testament prophets. Generally speaking, the method used by rulers to convey messages to each other began with the ruler who was sending the message speaking it orally in the presence of the messenger or ambassador who was to take it to the ruler who was to receive it. When the messenger came into the presence of the receiving ruler, he repeated verbatim the message that he had heard spoken by the sending ruler. Westermann traces the formal structure that the message came to take. The sending king would identify himself, would name the ruler who was to receive the message, would add a kind of preamble describing why the message was being sent, and would then state the message. There is an example of this in the book of Judges, when the judge Jephthah and the king of the Ammonites send messages to each other prior to beginning hostilities against each other. Jephthah wants to know why the Ammonite king is hostile. The king replies that the Israelites occupied Ammonite territory during their journey from Egypt to Canaan, and they must now return it peacefully or expect war. Jephthah replies, and here we get part of the messenger formula. Jephthah sent messages again to the king of the Ammonites and said to him, "Thus says Jephthah." There then follows a long account of what happened when the Israelites were on their journey from Egypt and how, when various kings would not allow passage to the Israelites through their territory, they had to resort to force to proceed on their way. The occupation of Ammonite land was accidental, but it was also decreed by God. After this preamble, the main message follows, introduced by the word therefore. "I therefore have not sinned against you and you do me wrong by making war on me. What we see in this account is the self-identification of the message. Thus says Jephthah, the preamble, and the message introduced by therefore. When we look at the book of Jeremiah in particular, we see a prophet using this formula with the difference that the prophet is not a messenger from another ruler to the king of Judah. He is a messenger from God. The implication is that the prophet has stood in the court of God and is now repeating the message that he heard God speak. A good example comes in the incident that I related earlier, when Jeremiah's scroll is cut up by King Jehoiakim and burned in the brazier. The following word comes from God to the prophet. Thus saith the Lord, the identification of the speaker, thou hast burned this roll, saying, why hast thou written therein, saying, the king of Babylon shall certainly come and destroy this land, and shall cause to cease from thence man and beast? Therefore, thus saith the Lord of Jehoiakim, king of Judah, he shall have none to sit upon the throne of David, and his dead body shall be cast out in the day to the heat, and in the night to the frost. And I will punish him and his seed and his servants for their iniquity. And I will bring upon them and upon the inhabitants of Jerusalem and upon the men of Judah all the evil that I have pronounced against them, but they hearkened not. The messenger formula, with its implication that the prophet had come hot foot from the very presence of God to convey God's message, must have made a considerable impression, and it is an indispensable item in any consideration of the performance side of the prophetic ministries. By concentrating in this lecture on the performance side of the work of the prophets, I have neglected the poetic side, and this I must put right in next week's lecture. I shall consider the four so-called servant songs in Isaiah 42-53 as poetry and ask what such an approach can tell us about what they mean.